Welcome, Denver, to ArtScene. I'm Michael Gadlin, a 20-year veteran artist and your host. I'm so glad to have you hang with me today. We've got a fantastic show for you. You won't want to miss it. Great guest interviews, demonstrations, and much, much more. So get ready for this journey with me, discovering arts and culture in Denver. Today on ArtScene, we'll feature Cheryl McCallum from the Source Theater Company, artist Karen Rail for an abstract painting demonstration, the new street mural at VSA Access Gallery, and Dancing with the Denver Stars. We have the great pleasure of having Karen Rail right in studio with us. She's an abstract painter who also teaches at the Art Students League of Denver, and she's going to do a demo for us. Karen, so your demo is really a process for you. Tell me about what you're going to do.
Thank you, Michael.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
I'm going to start by showing everybody how I approach a blank canvas. Which is sometimes an intimidating thing for people, but through my method, it's very friendly. So we're going to approach it as if this is a person who you'd like to meet, and you're just going to step up to the canvas and introduce yourself with paint. You're going to have a paintbrush loaded with whatever color you'd like to start with, and move up to the canvas, and you will make a mark, and I'll show you just how you do that. I know that sounds very difficult to do, but it's really very simple, as simple as it sounds. I often start with India ink, black India ink, because I like the contrast. And I start with a variety of sizes of brushes. This is sort of a large one, but this is the smallest one I start with, and I move up to larger brushes to make my first marks. So, here we go. Ooh, it's scary. There's a stranger up there, and I'm going to go say hi. So, here we go. Hello. That's how you say hello in paint. Ooh, what does that look like? So, I'm going to continue. I'm going to say the next thing and try and make it interesting. Maybe something a little bolder, like where are you from? Getting personal. Back and forth. India ink is really nice because it's got a really nice flow to it, so you can make a nice long mark and the paint will continue to drag across the canvas with your brush. A lot of regular paint, you'll sort of run out of the paint before you get very far. So when you try this, I'll ask you to mix a little bit of water. Make sure your paint is nice and soupy, and if you need to add a little water to it to get it to that soupy place, then go ahead and do that. We can also, I don't think we have a lot of extra supplies, but in my process, I like to mix brush marks with pencil marks of various kinds. I've got just ordinary grease pencils that I use in black and white and also some other colors. And I'll add those on here for some variety. We're still at the beginning of a conversation with this new canvas. And here's some graphite in different weights. And I even have a little bit of oil bar, which represents a little bit of the rebellious nature in me, in that oil and water aren't supposed to mix, because this is going to be continued in acrylic paint. But I've often wondered, well, what would happen if I mixed oil and water? And turns out nothing so far, nothing too drastic anyway, except for it creates cracks and interesting lines that I consider to be additional marks.
So let me ask you this with all the variety just quickly, while we have a few seconds. That kind of variety, I kind of consider like spontaneity, and it's very intuitive. So what's kind of going through your mind as you're just quickly, and like, so what's as you're pushing that through, what are you thinking about as far as composition or laying those strokes down, or are you not thinking about any of that?
Not thinking about any of that at this stage. Yeah, early on in this process, it's just about being fearless and playful, right, and just putting down marks that you are feeling like putting down intuitively and not thinking about where they go. And all throughout the painting process, it's very much like that. There's a time for your judgments to come in, but they're really minimal. Most of the art process needs to be intuitive.
Intuitive. Oh, I only want to stop you there because minimal and not thinking too much. I love those words because then you don't have to like think all in the beginning. It has to be a masterpiece, right?
Absolutely.
So, thank you for that. Thank you so much. Now, let's take a look at a very special new street mural. This was created through Arts and Venues Denver in a graffiti prevention and youth development program, Urban Arts Fund.
If we didn't have art, people would be totally dysfunctional, I think, because art, you know, art's done a lot for me, and if I didn't have art, who knows, I'd probably be in jail or something, you know, so yeah, it's not really funny, but it's the truth, you know, art pretty much saved my life.
Today we're just rocking a mural, part two of our first mural over here, so we're continuing this and wrapping it around the rest of the building. Some of the students that join our summer program, just having fun and just learning spray painting techniques and trying to add value to our community through our mural.
I've been working at the VSA for about 3 or 4 years. My specialty is graffiti, street art and graffiti.
VSA is a nonprofit gallery working with people with disabilities through the arts. And we have a little gallery here in the Arts District on Santa Fe. We've been here for a little over 10 years. The bulk of the young people that come to us have some sort of emotional, developmental, or cognitive delay. So our mission is to increase economic opportunity for particularly young people with disabilities. A lot of people that are like 16 to 21 year old, they really are very much locked out of traditional economic opportunity. So that's what we do. We sell art, we hustle art, we make murals, we do a little bit of everything.
I got involved though. It was back in high school and I was in job training. And then I got hired to this very job here. And I started to like it here. And I decided to do some graffiti. And guess what? It had this spot right here for me.
It's awesome. I mean, the students here in the city have a lot of character and flavor and funk. And so I love vibing out with them and just creating stuff.
What are you doing out here today?
We're gonna do graffiti art. It's my first time doing it. And I think I liked it now because it's not just, you know, about art. It's doing also with creativity. That's what I like about it.
Yeah, I started off as a student. I had got into a car accident a while back, and I had a head injury, so I had a lot of trouble remembering things for a while, and I had a lot of trouble for some years, so I'm good now. You know, I started helping out, teaching, and
almost everything we do collaboratively. So these students, we had to work on the sketch together, we had to come up with the ideas and the concept and really talk about what was going to work. So it really wasn't about just getting my own individual expression across, but working on a team. Sometimes our students haven't ever worked for a quote-unquote boss, and Josiah and Rata are the bosses out here. They're the ones that are making the color decisions and the color choices and working with the students and teaching them that kind of stuff.
So the name of the mural is The Sirens of 9th Avenue. It's more of a decorative kind of mural. It's not anything socio-political or anything. It's just something to look at. That's kind of nice. And what it is, the body of a mermaid sleeping, and then there's her daughters that are coming up out of the water. So each, there's like three different faces that are going to be in the mural, coming up, emerging. The hair is kind of like when you see the reflection of, off a glass, or like when a rainstorm, like you see the rainbow colors kind of. So we kind of like try to emulate that with the hair, and then she's a mermaid, so her skin's blue, you know? She's not a human.
How important do you think the arts are? I think it's very important because it's like gives people to like a way to express themselves and to get their emotions out, and it just needs to be, I think it needs to be more like out there and stuff instead of just social media. I think it just needs to be all over like cities and stuff like that.
Every one of the kids that comes through our program can draw because they've been sitting at the back of the class not knowing really what's going on, and art is a way for them to communicate in a very different way. I also believe that the arts is a way to push society a little bit. Sometimes that tension is a good thing.
Where we have a huge responsibility of painting this mural because everybody's gonna see it. So we wanted to make sure whatever we paint it will help uplift the community through our colors, through our shapes, and through our whole design. And so, you know, it's an honor and pleasure to work with these students and the organization, and also my friend Josiah Lopez.
Well, I'd just like to say, you know, this thing really does help out a lot of people, you know. Thanks to them, I would have never done this in my life.
So it's my personal belief that the arts and creativity will be the way that we solve the problems of the world. I think that we need some creative thinking. I think we need some outside the box thinking. And so the arts really do lend themselves to that. We're a creative people, we're very artistic. And so adding a little color to the world is kind of nice.
That's pretty much it. We're rock stars.
What a cool addition to the Arts District. When we come back, more with Karen Rail and Cheryl McCallum from the Source Theater Company. So we're back with Karen, and it looks like you've gone partway through this thing, and I'm curious to know where you're at now. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about what brought you to this point?
Yeah, I've sort of been playing, just not having too much intention at this stage, but just concentrating on putting down marks with different tools and materials, and I'm just going to continue in that way and build up the layers. It's really, really important for the depth of a painting to paint in layers, to go ahead and paint over stuff you've already put down and just build it up. And some of that, as we get to some of the top layers, it becomes more conscious. But a lot of the underneath layers are just playful and intuitive, subconscious.
Now, is it sort of like, you know, when I'm working, I always think of like, I edit later, but is this that point where you said something about sort of thinking about the layering and the marks? Does this all come into play, like think about composition, or is it still too early to really start composing?
For me, it's still too early to think about composing.
Okay.
That starts to reveal itself as we get to the top layers.
Right.
I know that that's different than what a lot of artists do. They think of the composition first,
sure.
But I think of it last.
Okay, good. Good answer. I love it. Good, good, good.
So I'm just going to continue adding marks to this, and I've got a palette knife, just one of those simple little plastic ones that you get at the hardware stores, and it creates a different kind of a mark than brushes do. So I think it needs some light, so I've dipped it into some white paint, and I'm going to drag it down here.
And as you're doing that, I'm curious, that looks really thick. Did you put a thickener in that, or is that just regular paint? I almost thought it was like plaster.
It does have plaster mixed in with
it.
It's not the powdery plaster, but it's the Venetian plaster.
Ooh.
Again, a hardware store
awesome.
Material. Yeah.
See, all these different materials, I love it, and it just creates a rich piece. And I know it's going to be great because we're going to see more of the end of this in just a few. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Awesome. Love it. That's great stuff. We'll leave you to it while we take a few moments with Cheryl McCallum right now, here from the Source Theater Company. Hi, Cheryl. Thank you for being here on
My
the
pleasure.
Show. This
My
is
pleasure.
So awesome.
Thank
I appreciate you,
you
here.
You.
Absolutely. So I was doing a little bit of research on the Source Theater Company, and you guys have a great rich history. And I put in my notes that it's got to be the most significant theater company in our region because of how inclusive it is. How did it get its start?
Yeah, it started, I guess, back a few years ago.
Okay.
And with Jimmy Walker, Hugo Sales, Arnold King.
Yes.
Got together and started wanted to create
an inclusive theater company, but also to develop black artists doing their own writing, directing, all of that. And so they've come together through the history of Ulipians and the Denver Black Arts Company, and they'd like to collaborate. Yeah. And that's why I think it's so important, especially for a small theater company, to be able to collaborate with different artists and just bring in different artists of different genres.
Yeah.
And that's how I got involved with them when I came back to Denver.
Right, and I think that's so wonderful. And I'll ask you something about your history, too, and what brought you here. The collaborative part that you talked about, it totally enriches the experience in artists, because when you feed off of each other, I mean, you end up getting a lot more. You learn so much more.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I read something about your history and experience in The Lion, some big productions, The Lion King?
Yes, yes.
So tell me a little bit about your history.
And
what brought you here, too? After
well, that? I'm a native of Denver.
Okay.
So born and raised. Went to South High,
Nice. And, East High. I'm just saying. Got to give East love.
I thought I was going to go to East. And started with my brother years ago, had the Denver Black Arts Company.
Okay.
Back in the early 80s.
Right.
And so I was around theater a lot, but not thinking that I would participate in it. I'm more of a singer than I claimed to be an actress at the time. And just I moved to New York because I wanted to study voice and started getting reluctantly involved in theater and found out that I absolutely love it. And
your true calling, so
my true calling, exactly. Right.
If you don't find it, it'll find you.
It will find you, and that's what it did. So it found me, and I haven't turned my back on it yet. And wound up just kept auditioning. Thank you.
And you continue. Yeah.
Found out myself auditioning and kept auditioning and wound up not wound up, but in The Lion King, and spent over a decade on Broadway. There, I know I have
now
the back to prove.
That's an experience.
Yeah.
Right. Is that where you really cut your teeth?
Exactly.
And like, baptism by fire. I'm like, I'm in this.
Yeah. Well, there are regional productions that I've done as well.
Right.
But
right.
you know, I happened to get a good one, good Broadway show on my first one. So it's
that's
great.
A lot having that under your belt.
Thank
Very
you.
Nice. Very nice.
And then came back to Denver and.
Yeah. And all this. So real quick, if you had to give, because we've got a lot of people watching who might be interested in theater who are newbies, what kind of advice would you give them? Just a little tidbit, a nugget, if anyone is just coming in for the first time. With your rich experience.
Yeah. I would say learn everything.
Yeah.
Learn everything from building a set to painting a set to knowing how to direct, to write, build a costume, from dressing, wardrobe, everything. Yeah. Learn everything you can and learn an instrument.
Yes.
That's my biggest regret.
See, I regret not doing that.
Me too.
Dang.
Me too. Yeah.
But that's good advice.
But to learn an instrument and just to learn everything, get an all knowledge of all the genres possible.
Yeah.
If you're a singer, learn how to dance. If you're a dancer, learn how to act. If you, you know, so all of it, and just learn everything.
Love it. Well said. And quickly, greatest inspiration or mentor?
I think my greatest inspiration, my family, my mother, my late brothers. She exposed us to art of all kinds.
Nice.
So from symphonies.
Like a great family.
I did.
I did, and do. Yeah, and it's no surprise you're here doing your thing.
Thank you. Thank you.
So thank you so much for being
pleasure.
With us.
My pleasure.
I mean, we got to know a little bit about what you do.
Yeah.
One thing I don't want to forget to mention is you're hosting a new show called Monday.
Monday. Whoop, whoop, Cabaret.
Yeah, I love it. And so if you don't know when that comes on, that's your own fault. Because
that's
it's
right.
obvious.
Yes, yes. The third Monday.
Yep.
Yes.
Cheryl McCallum,
thank you so much for being in studio
with us. This is wonderful.
Me too. It's a pleasure.
Thanks. So we'll come right back with more Karen Rayl. Now, let's turn to a night of dancing with the Denver Stars, a benefit for Cleo Parker Robinson Dance.
I'm Cleo Parker Robinson, and this is our 45th anniversary, and we are doing Dancing with the Denver Stars, our sixth year, and what a night.
something we all do. It's universal. We all dance. And so I've had fun, a joy, a ball, really dancing and getting to know some of the professional dancers and really understand what it's like to be a part of a company like this.
I'm here tonight to support the Cleo Parker Robinson Dance Company. They have done an incredible job giving back to the community and really supporting the arts and education in Denver.
Thank you so much.
It was an incredible performance. I think the Cleo Parker Robinson Dance Studio for 45 years has been doing tremendous work, and I'm a big supporter.
We've been rehearsing for about 6 weeks with a little break in there, but we probably had about 10 or 12 rehearsals over that time period.
She's been a trooper throughout the entire process.
Oh my God, man, we had 6 rehearsals, and it's a matter of filming yourself rehearsing and studying that tape over and over and over again and making sure you just get the timing down and the steps down. I really wanted to make sure I didn't make my partner look bad because she's a professional dancer and she worked hard to choreograph it, and I was proud of the work she did.
I love it. I love it. That's why I stay. That's why I'm here. We not only do we tour nationally and internationally, but we also go into the schools and we change lives with our education programs. There are so many young boys that I love to inspire with dance. And with the Cleo Parker Robinson Dance Education Programs, I'm able to do that.
Cleo Parker Robinson Dance provides education programs for more than 40 schools, community organizations, churches, charter programs, correctional facilities across the Denver metro area every year. What we really try to do is we try to bring children and students from different demographics together to share the stage where they lose what it is to be a demographic, a stereotype. Their economic background doesn't matter. They just come together on a creative stage where they can be young, evolutioning artists together.
Fun. She was gorgeous. That's all I have to say. She was gorgeous. She was beautiful.
He made me look good.
This was something different, where it was choreographed, you had to hit your points, and it was theater. It was awesome.
I was not able to dance this year, but I'm glad that my good friend and our mayor, Michael B. Hancock, danced. You know, he did a good job. He did much better than I thought he would do. You know, he has 2 left feet, but he had a right and a left foot tonight, and he did an amazing job. I'm so proud of him, and I'm proud that he was able to draw a huge crowd, and we raised a lot of money for the Clear Parker Robinson Dance Studio for all these kids in our neighborhoods.
So very important. It's a huge economic generator, but it's also so much about who we are. It helps us compete globally. Right now, we have the best performing arts complex in the entire world, and we need to keep that going. And the only way we do that is by introducing our very young and all different ethnicities and races and age groups to the arts. And no matter what type of arts it is, keep introducing, keep bringing them to it. And so I'm proud to be a little bit, play a little part of that tonight.
I really believe everybody, if they dance more, they feel healthier, happier, and they would know how to be kind and joyous because they will feel this inclusive and vibrant village that they belong to.
We're back with Karen Rail and her abstraction here that she's done her third part. So Karen, close up for us. What's taken it to this point?
This is just a buildup of layers, and some come together quickly and some take a little longer to pull together. But luckily, this one came together in no time. So
it really did. All that work. Yeah. You sort of chiseled in to really, now it's yes. Composed. Now you've sort of talked about the composition.
Yes, brought in some of the light areas that sort of featured this central, all these dark areas that I worked in the underlayers.
Yeah, creates a great contrast.
Yeah, kind of contrast. Amazing. I love contrast in paintings.
Exactly. Yeah. Well said. And Karen, thanks so much for being here in studio.
Oh,
we loved having you. I love seeing the process. Thanks so much. And thank you for joining us in studio, folks. Until next time, when we discover more of Denver's art scene.